It's a pleasure to introduce Professor Ron Adin from Bar-Ilan University in Ramat Gan, Israel, who will be the second speaker in this semester, talking about very interesting work. In the abstract, start with Richard Stanley, so it might be very interesting. Hi, Ron. Go ahead.
Yeah, just a second. So thank you, Doron, for the invitation, and good evening, let's say, everyone. First, a small clarification. The title of this talk has an adjective cyclic, and it should go with all the nouns there. So it's actually a bit longer than written: cyclic permutations, cyclic shuffles, and also cyclic quasi-symmetric functions. And this is this talk is about a joint work with Ira Gessel, Vic Reiner, and Yuval Roichman. Some of them are here. And I would like to extend special thanks to Dari Greenberg, which is who is a neighbor of yours in some wide sense. I don't know. Okay. And I would like to talk about a certain result of Richard Stanley, an extension of it, and especially one of the tools that are needed for the extension. And it's a question whether the topic is the result or the tool. We'll see. So here's the outline. First, I'd like to introduce Richard's result and the concepts that it involves. Then I'll describe our cyclic analog of it, and then the tools that we used to prove it. All right. Let's start with some basic notions. I apologize to the experts that know it very well, more than me, probably. And those are permutations, shuffles, and descents. Right, so let A be a finite alphabet, and I will denote by SA the set of permutations of A in a slightly unconventional fashion. I mean sequences or words of words which contain each of the letters of the alphabet exactly once. So there are bijections for this from the set one up to little a, the size of the set, to the set itself. And for example, if the alphabet contains these numbers 1, 3, 5, 7, 8, here we have a permutation U of these letters. Of course, if the set consists of the numbers 1 up to n, then this is the good old symmetric group. In general, of course, it's not a group, but it's a nice set. So those are permutations. Shuffles. Suppose we have two disjoint alphabets, A and B, and we have a word, a permutation U of A and the permutation V of B. Then U, Shin, V, or U, Shavi, could be interpreted in Hebrew and Russian, is the set of all shuffles of U and V, and I'll define shuffles by example. So here is an example. We have these two alphabets, A and B, and those two permutations, 1, 2, 3, 5, 7, 6, 4. And the shuffle, one of the shuffles, is a word that contains each of the letters once, and such that restricted to each of the alphabets A and B, we have the original words. So the blue letters are in the order 1, 2, 3, 5, that's the order of U, and the red letters are in the order 7, 6, 4, that's the order of V. So those are permutations, shuffles, and now descents. For that, we need A to be linearly totally ordered. For example, it could be a set of integers with the usual order. And the descent set of a permutation or a word in this alphabet, of a permutation in this alphabet, is the set of all indices I such that U of I is larger than U of I plus one. Of course, I interpret, as I did before, the word as a function. Okay, so it's a set of indices. The descent number is the size of this set, cardinality of this set. For example, this the U that we see here has the indices of the descent are denoted by these little marks underneath. So 8, for instance, is larger than 7, and therefore 2, the index, the place of 8 is a descent. And 7 is larger than 2, therefore 3 is a descent. And 2 is larger than 1, 3 is a descent, and 6 is larger than 5, therefore 7 is a descent. And altogether, there are 4 descents for this permutation. And here is the question that we want to answer. The question is, what is the distribution of the descent number over the shuffles of two given words? Suppose we have U and V, two given words in disjoint alphabets, and we'd like to know what's the distribution of the descent number. For example, So one point of this distribution is what are the minimum and maximum values attained by the descent number on this set of shuffles. Let us take this example. Okay. So U is 1432. That's a question to the audience. And V is this permutation 6-5. And my question to you is, what do you think is the minimal and what is the maximal value of the descent number on all shuffles of these words? So U has two descents, V has one descent. What do you think is the minimal possible descent of a shuffle?
The sum?
That's an answer to minimal or to maximal?
Minimal
is the sum, so we say the minimum is 3 and the maximum.
I don't know.
Anyone would like to venture?
Well, 8.
What do you think the maximum is? And just for a guess, the number
maybe
of
2 and 5, I don't know.
5. So 3 to 5, you are almost there. Here's the set of all shuffles, 15 of them, of course. 6, choose 4. And here's the distribution. The minimal descent number is 2, and the maximum is 4. Right? You see here. So, for instance,
How do we compare the alphabet of U with the alphabet of V? Or does it matter for the distribution?
That's right. We need A union B to be linearly ordered. Excellent question.
You mean in any way? So you get the same answer?
An even better question. Yes, I'll address this. Yes, in any way. So A and B are, let's say, disjoint sets of integers.
Okay.
Okay. You see this distribution has some nice properties. And this result of Richard Stanley that is this topic of this talk is the following. Suppose we have an alphabet A of size little a, an alphabet B of size little b, they are disjoint and linearly ordered, and the union is linearly ordered. And we have two words, U over A and V over B. We know the descent numbers of U and of V. Then the number of shuffles of U and V, which have a specific descent number, let's say K, is this product of the binomials. That's the result. It's a very neat expression. It's from Stanley's PhD dissertation. It's one application of his theory of P partitions. For example, the example we saw, this U, the U and V that we saw, this is the expression, and of course we see that the K is no less than 2 and no more than 4, and actually the values are 3, 9, 3. All right. You can see that this, of course, has nice properties. It's symmetric, it's unimodal. All right, so that's the basic result. Actually, this nice result was reproved. There are bijective proofs by Ian Goulden and by Jonathan Stadler. And some remarks, some of them addressing Victor's questions. Is first of all, the note that the formula does not depend on the dependence on the permutations is only through their descent numbers. So it only depends on the descent numbers of the permutations. It does not depend on the relative order, as you asked, of A and B. Actually, there is a more general statement. I'll say something about it. Actually, this is a special case of Stanley's theorem. And the thing that we would like to use is that it follows, or one way to prove it, not the way, well, one way to prove it is to multiply quasi-symmetric functions, which I will define, of course. So this is the basic result, and our question is, what is its cyclic analog? What is the cyclic analog of Richard's theorem? For that, we'll have, of course, to define the cyclic notion, the relevant cyclic notions, and that's what we'll do right now. So we need the cyclic permutations, cyclic shuffles, cyclic descents. What is a cyclic permutation? You can guess. Suppose we have an alphabet A, then a cyclic permutation is an equivalence class of permutations under cyclic shifts, like that. So 1, 4, 3, 2, 4, 3, 2, 1, 3, 2, 1, 4, 2, 1, 4, 3. So each of these cycles, equivalence classes or orbits under the cyclic direction of the cyclic group, we call it a cyclic permutation. And we have a notation CSA for the set, for this quotient set. Okay, cyclic notation are cyclic shuffles. Cyclic shuffles, suppose U and V are words, are permutations in this joint, over this joint alphabet. Then a cyclic shuffle is a shuffle of a cyclic shift of U and a cyclic shift of V, like here. Right, U and V are those permutations. And this W is a cyclic shuffle of U and V because the blue letters are in the order 3, 4, 1, 2, which is a cyclic shift of U. And the red letters are in the order 7, 8, 9, 5, 6, which is a cyclic shift of V. So the set of all cyclic shuffles is we denoted by shin C or sha C. So, okay. And the third concept, the cyclic descent set. Now we need A to be totally ordered. And the cyclic descent set is almost the same as the descent set, namely the set of all indices for which indices I, for which U of I is larger than U of I plus one. But here we also allow I to be A, to be the last letter. And we say that the last letter is the last index is a descent if the last letter is larger than the first letter. So if you write the word cyclically, you have this end there. Okay, for instance, suppose we have this permutation. We see that the 2, 4 is larger than 1 and 6 is larger than 3, therefore 2 and 5 are descents, but also the last letter 3 is larger than the first letter 2, therefore 6 is cyclic descent. So the set of cyclic descents also includes 6. And on the other hand, for this V, since 2 is less than 3, 6 is not this. So the cyclic descent set is the same as the usual descent set. So those are the concepts. Any questions about those? Okay, so those are the cyclic analogs of the concept we saw. Concepts we saw, and
it's always larger. The cyclic descent is always larger than the descent, right?
The cyclic descent number is always either the descent number or one more.
Yeah.
Indeed. And this concept was actually introduced in a wider sense. This is the type A version, and Paolo Cellini introduced this concept for any vowel group, and it was studied by Dilix, Peterson, Stembridge, and others. Okay, so this is a concept, not so trivial concept. And also we have some remarks about that. Note that the number of cyclic descents, the number, is invariant under cyclic shifts, of course, right? And therefore we can define the cyclic descent number of the equivalence class of the cyclic, corresponding cyclic permutation, right? It's independent of the shift. Of the cyclic descent set does depend. It's not invariant, but it's equivariant, okay? And also if we have two permutations U and V, the set of cyclic shuffles is a union of equivalence clusters. And therefore we can say that it consists of cyclic permutations in some abuse of notation. Okay, so it's a union of cyclic permutations. And therefore we can at least formulate the question, given U and V, and looking at all the cyclic shuffles of the cyclic permutation bracket U and the cyclic permutation bracket V, what is the distribution of the cyclic descent number? So this is the perfect cyclic analog of the question that we asked before. And this is the main specific result that I would like to show you. And here it is, this is our result, that indeed under those circumstances, the answer is what you see here. I would like to keep the suspense for a while, and so there's a number that should go there, a formula. What it is exactly, I'll show a little later. But okay, that's the result. Any questions about it? Yeah, okay. Right, so right now I want to talk
about... Is it already published somewhere on the internet?
Yes, as you see, the date is roughly 2021. Yeah, it's on the archive, of course.
Oh, so I can go to the archive and find out.
And it is to appear. It has been accepted and it's waiting in line. Okay, so the main tool that we would like to use or introduce are cyclic quasi-symmetric functions. And I'll, introduce them. But first, let me recall the more classical notions of symmetric and quasi-symmetric functions. So here's the formal definition of symmetric functions. Let's look at the example. It's a very well-known concept. So it's a formal power series. In infinitely many, let's say infinitely many variables, x1, x2, x3, and so forth. And with each monomial, say x1 to the power 4, x2 to squared, and times x3 to the power 5, with this, each such monomial, we also have all the permutations of the variables or of the exponents, as you like. So all the 6 permutations also appear as monomials in this formal power series with the same coefficient, and also all similar monomials when you take any 3 distinct variables instead of x1, x2, and x3. So, right? So this is a symmetric function. The quasi-symmetric function is somewhat less known. This is a concept introduced by Ira Gessel, following, Richard's permutations. And it's the following. So again, here's the formal definition, but we'll define it by example. Suppose we have this monomial again. Now we don't require the permutations of the powers or the variables to appear, but we do so. But you see the variables appear here in increasing order. It's x1, x2, x3. We do require that all monomials with increasing variables of any set of indices, or any set of indices, and with the same powers will appear with the same coefficient. So all those and many others have to be in the formal power series as soon as the first monomial is. So, okay, x1, x2, x3, x1, x2, x4, x1, x2, x5, x7, x10, x million, and so forth, but only in this order. This is quasi-symmetric, it's not necessarily symmetric. And here's the new concept that I would like to introduce. It's called the cyclic quasi-symmetric functions. Here's again a formal definition, but let's see the example. We have again our favorite monomial, x1 to the power 4, x2 squared, and x3 to the power 5. But we see the quasi-symmetric version, we see below the symmetric version, and the cyclic quasi-symmetric version is somewhere in between. And it says that together with this monomial, we also have all the cyclic shifts of the, let's say, the exponents. So together with 4, 2, 5, we also have 2, 5, 4, and 5, 4, 2. So all those monomials also appear, also have the same coefficient, but not the other not necessarily the other permutations. So it's not necessarily symmetric, but does have some sort of symmetry, a cyclic one. Right? So it's in between quasi and symmetric and symmetric. Okay, is this clear? This is a new concept. Is it clear what I mean by this? And of course, again, as in the quasi-symmetric case, also x1, x2, x4, x7, x10, x12, and so forth. Okay, this is the concept. And I'd like to briefly review several properties of this concept. So first of all, so let's compare these. So I use a notation sim for the set of all symmetric functions. CQCM for QCM for all quasi-symmetric functions, CQCM for the cyclic quasi-symmetric functions. All of those are graded rings, or if we work over a field, they are algebras. They are not the same. They have these inclusion relations, obvious inclusion relations. Their nth graded pieces have natural bases. And they are indexed by well-known combinatorial objects. So in the symmetric case, there are well-known bases, for example, the basis consisting of show functions, there are many others. And they are all indexed by partitions of the integer n. In the quasi-symmetric case, there are bases, for example, the basis of fundamental functions, and they are indexed by compositions of the number n, or equivalently by subsets of the set 1 up to n minus 1. Compositions, let's say. And this in the cyclic quasi-symmetric case, there's also a basis, and it's indexed by cyclic equivalence classes of subsets or of compositions with some technicalities. In particular, the dimensions of the corresponding gated pieces of the all finite. So in the symmetric case, the dimension is P of n, number of partitions of n, and by the Hardy-Ramanujan formula, it's sub-exponential. It's asymptotically, it's a constant to the power square root of n. In the quasi-symmetric case, it's the number of compositions of n, which is precisely 2 to the n minus 1. Question? Yes, Volodya mentioned some algebraic properties. Maybe there's a question. Ah, okay. Maybe I'll address it later. And in the cyclic case, the number is this formula, the number of equivalence classes of compositions, and it's roughly 2 to the n divided by n. Volodya Retach mentions in the chat that quasi-symmetric functions and symmetric functions are Hopf algebras, and there is a dual to the, so symmetric functions are self-dual, but quasi-symmetric functions, their dual is, actually there are two duals, depending on what co-product one uses. So one of the duals is non-commutative symmetric functions, and he asks, what's the dual of the cyclic quasi-symmetric functions? It's not an elegant thing that, it's not an elegant, something that I can easily write down. Either of the co-products. Well, it's a good question, but I think it doesn't have a simple answer. Okay. Right. Another similarity between these algebras is the following. There is a famous involution omega. On symmetric functions, it maps the sure function S lambda to the sure function S lambda prime, where lambda prime is the conjugate partition. Transpose diagram. For quasi-symmetric functions, the involution exchanges set J, let's say set J with its complement in the set 1 to n minus 1. And also in the cyclic quasi-symmetric case, it exchanges J with the complement, but this time the complement in the set of numbers 1 up to n. So we are similar but somewhat distinct. And the property that is most important to us is that the product in the, so the product, we don't talk about product of sure functions, it has to do with Richardson coefficients, but the product of quasi-symmetric functions is directly related to shuffles, as you can see here. Right, so if you have a fundamental quasi-symmetric function indexed by the cyclic descent set of some U, and similarly for V, then the product is just the sum of Fs over all the shuffles of U and V. This is a formula of Ira Gessel. And it relates, of course, just that if we want to talk about shuffles, then we actually want to talk about multiplication of quasi-symmetric functions. And it turns out that the other definition that we saw before, a very similar phenomenon happens in the cyclic world, as you can see before, below. There are also some half similarities, some similarities with differences. For example, each skew shaw function indexed by a skew shape lambda mu, so each shaw function is a linear combination with non-negative integer coefficients of the basis elements of the fundamental quasi-symmetric functions. And it turns out that a similar property is true in the cyclic case, but not always. It happens exactly when the shape lambda minus mu is not a ribbon, or ribbon was also a rim hook or a border strip. So in case it is a ribbon, the coefficients are not necessary, are not all non-negative. But in other cases, they are. It's a quite interesting phenomenon. So therefore I wrote it below in some fashion. So Gessel's result in the classical quasi-symmetric case is that this shaw function is the sum over all standard Gdyankov laws of this skew shape. And the index is the descent set of the tableau. This is the definition of that. And a similar phenomenon happens in the cyclic case, but it's not so clear what to do because I defined very easily cyclic descents for permutations because then you can compare the last letter to the first one. But for I didn't define what the descent set of a Young tableau is. For those, many of you who know it, it's quite clear that at least if the shape is not skew, it's regular shape. The one is the in the top left corner, and n is somewhere else, and therefore one is never below n. So you can't just naively define cyclic descents as we did here, but it turns out that there is a way to define, and the way to do it is to introduce some axioms. In any case, it's a very interesting line of results, starting from a seminal result of Benton Rhodes 10 or 11 years ago. It has to do with the rectangular shapes, and then there's a sequence of other results. Anyway, there is a whole theory of cyclic descents for tableaus, and this gives this formula like that. Another difference from the non-cyclic case is that we need a normalization. I didn't stress it before. So there are two flavors of this basis, but if we want integer structure coefficients, we'd better normalize. You see, if we have a subset of 1 to n, suppose n is not prime, suppose n is 6, then some subsets of 1 to 6 have symmetry, cyclic symmetry, like the set 1 and 4 has symmetry. There's a stabilizer, okay? There's a need to normalize. A peculiar and unique phenomenon that only appears here in the cyclic case is that there is a linear dependence. See, there is a presumable basis elements have actually a unique linear dependence. Therefore, we must leave one of them outside. For example, the one corresponding to J empty. there's a linear dependence. And there's also a property which we call the non-Escher. It's the following. So we talk about permutations, right? And we saw the definition of the cyclic descent set of a permutation. So which permutation has an empty cyclic descent set? To have an empty cyclic descent set, we need an empty descent set, and this only happens when does it happen? Which permutation has an empty descent set?
Identity.
Just the identity, right? It has to be increasing, monotone increasing, but then the last entry is larger than the first. Therefore, the cyclic descent set is not empty. And then similarly, a cyclic descent set cannot contain all the numbers 1 to n. Right? So a non-Escher is because of Escher's famous, one of Escher's famous drawings, ascending and descending. Yes, it's infinitely ascending this staircase. Imagine paradoxical staircase. So this can't happen from permutations, right? The cyclic descent set cannot be empty or full, but the corresponding basis elements are indispensable, right? The one corresponding to the empty set is the complete homogeneous symmetric function, Hn. The one corresponding to the full set is index set is the elementary symmetric function. And when you are the natural algebra then generators of symmetric functions, you can't do without them. So there's some tension here, some question what to do. So there are some technicalities which maybe expose some deeper things. So there are some differences. Okay, let me mention some other ingredients that we need. First of all, there are several ways to do it, but one way is to introduce a new product to the ring of a formal power series in a variable Q. And the product of Q to the I and Q to the J is defined to be Q to the maximum of IJ. So this is sort of a tropical product. And it turns out that if one defines a homomorphism, let's call it psi, from a formal power series in variables x1, x2, and so forth. This so the first ring formal power series in the x's has the usual product, and we map it to this new ring with the new product. And the definition is a linear extension of, so if we have a monomial in the X's, it is mapped to something that records only the index, the largest index of a variable that appears in the monomial. So the image of xi1 to the power m1 times xik to the power mk only records ik, the index of the largest index of a variable, Q to the IK. So this definition turns out to map the basis of the quasi-symmetric functions, the Fs, F of N of J, to this very simple generating function and very simple formal power series. And you see that the image only depends on the cardinality of J, not on the set itself. Therefore, we see here that the numbers, it does record numbers rather than the sets. So this is one gadget that we use. Maybe some of you know this person. Actually, it's the person in the t-shirt, and I would like to pay attention to the inscription that Don chose to to have on his on this t-shirt, right? You're gonna call. So this is an identity, a triple binomial identity, and it's actually a special case of a more general one, which is a hypergeometric type identity for 3F2. On the right hand side, this n bar is the usual rising factorial. So c to the power n bar is c times c plus 1 times c plus 2 times c plus n minus 1. And we do need the more general formula. Let me give you a brief history or partial history. I'm sure that Don can say much more, not only about the history, but also how what are the modern ways to prove, maybe to find, prove such identities, or this specific identity. So the hypergeometric formulation is due to Zaschutz from quite long ago, but actually it's equivalent to an even older formula of Pfaff more than 200 years ago. So it's a very old result. It has not so old combinatorial proofs by Cartier and Fouattat and by George Andrews. And it turns out that actually I hinted it at the beginning, but actually Stanley's original formulation is actually more refined than what I showed to you. And it describes the joint distribution of descent number and major index, where descent number is the size of the descent set and major index is the sum of the entries of the descent set. And for his formulation, he needed a Q analog of this formula, turns out. And it was proved by request by Gould, but actually it's also older, it's now more than 100 years old. And Gould's proof is a variation of a proof in the monthly of the non-Q version. Okay, this is a glimpse of the history of this interesting. One can find this this identity in.
You mean the Q analog of the Cyclic, the Q Cyclic?
What is the question?
This is, you're talking about the Q analog of the Cyclic identity.
So the two. So it's in the bottom of the page, I talk about the Q analog. Will I be speaking about it? No. So the Q analog is just each binomial coefficient you interpret as a Q binomial, and there's
and
also
you have some powers of Q.
A natural power of Q, of course, somewhere.
Okay. One comment. So I have a proof adapting the Fouattat proof of this for the Q case.
You mean a bijective proof?
Yeah.
Of the Q version.
I Q analogized for Fouattat's proof of two-dimensional proof.
Is your Q analog the one used by Stanley?
Yeah, I'm not sure, but
probably, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, how many Q analogs for such an identity can you have? Okay. How many true Q analogs can you have? Yes, okay. So I was right that you can say much more. Right, but you were patient enough to wait until this. So this is the statement of the result that we all waited for. So this is a cyclic version of Stanley's formula. You see the two binomial coefficients, but there is also some extra thing. Extra factor, of course, this is an integer. Okay, so this is an answer. Right. So let me sum up and maybe mention one open question. And I think Don, you said that should finish by in 48 minutes. I try to do that. Okay, so we saw the ring of cyclic quasi-symmetric functions, which is between symmetric and quasi-symmetric. It has properties, many of them common with the more classical ring of quasi-symmetric functions, but some are unique, peculiar, interesting, I think. And it does have applications. For example, we saw this cyclic version of Stanley's shuffling theorem. Let me mention an open question. You see, I mentioned here that Stanley's original result also involved, so it's a Q formula and it involves also major index. But unlike descent number, we don't know a natural cyclic version of major index. You see, major index is the sum of the entries in this descent set, and it's not really invariant under cyclic shifts. So we don't know how to formulate. So we don't have a candidate for the full result of Richard Stanley. Maybe
so, one. So Richard Stanley has major index and descents, both?
Yes, so descents are, you see.
The places, right?
Let's put in the, so here, descents is, the K is the number of descents.
Yeah.
Right? So I, J, and K are parameters in the formula. And the formula is a Q formula, and the power of Q is the major index. So even if you are given the descent number, you don't know the major index. But what is the cyclic major index is still a question, which one of you may one day answer. Thank you.
Thank you for very, very insightful talk. Are there any questions? We have time for questions or comments. In that case, I have a question. So here you have the final results, the punchline. You have a quotient times the Stanley results, right? So there was a Stanley result, and then you have some extra stuff. So is there a way to have a bijective proof of this by relating it to the old stuff, by multiplying this?
I would say probably yes, but it's an excellent question. Probably yes, it's an integer after all.
Yeah, that's fascinating. So right now it's an algebraic proof, but not
a bijective proof. Very algebraic proof, yes, indeed. I expect it does have a cyclic bijective proof.
Is a cyclic analogue of number of inversions?
A what?
Of the inv, the number of inversions, is a cyclic analogue.
Is there a cyclic analogue?
Would that make sense?
Not trivially, because you see, I less than J is not a clear, well,
right.
It's not a meaningful. So you may want to interpret inversion number as length, and then, but not obviously. Well, you can view the cyclic things as, you can say that they mirror some affine gadgets, right? Like affine permutations, or the affine symmetric group. So in this case, you can also talk about length, but okay. Then if so, but affine is infinite, so okay. Yeah. And it needs both. Okay. So. You should have some sort of a handle. Maybe full length.
Any other questions? Any or comments? But thanks for coming. Thanks, Ron, again.
Thank you.
This ends this talk. Thanks for coming. And see you next week.
Bye-bye. Okay, good to see everyone. We'll be back here again next week at the same time.
Thank you. Bye-bye.